This is where the launch director sits on launch day. Now this room is usually full of people and very, very busy on launch day, and this person right here is the one who's ultimately responsible for the safe launch of the space shuttle. But I gotta tell you, this is where you want to be, because located right outside these windows is the best view on launch day. Welcome to Launch Pad 39A, where we've launched about half the space shuttles. What happens is, when the whole shuttle vehicle arrives on the back of the mobile launch platform, you see that incline behind. Well, that's about a 5% grade, so the back end of the crawler's got to jack up by as much as 6 feet in order to keep that whole stack level while getting up to the pad surface. What you see up there right now is a mobile launch platform after the crawler has left, and that would have the space shuttle vehicle on top of it if we were about to go launch. Now, you also see up there something called the rotating service structure. What we do before the shuttle even arrives out at the launch pad is we bring the payload out to the pad and we insert it inside that payload changeout room. What happens is there's this big canister that looks almost exactly like the shuttle's payload bay. We'll bring the canister out, we'll pick it up, attach it to the payload changeout room, we'll open up all those doors you see there, and then this thing called the payload ground handling mechanism, or the PIGM, will reach out, grab the payload out of the canister, pull it inside the payload changeout room, we close all the doors, we can lower the canister down to the ground, then the whole shuttle vehicle arrives, we bring the rotating surface structure around to encompass the vehicle and provide protection from wind, rain, and digested seagull food. And then we can open up the payload bay doors on the orbiter, the PIGM will take the payload and insert it into the orbiter, we close all the payload bay doors, we bring the rotating surface structure back, and then we're ready to go fly. Tell you what, why don't we go on up there and have a closer look at the pad. Welcome to the 195-foot level of Pad A. Now, I'm wearing a hard hat today because there's no shuttle vehicle out here at the launch pad. But if this were launch morning and we were getting ready to go fly, the astronauts would just be in their spacesuits, and they would come out of this very same elevator, walk down this path, and right out there would be the swing arm, which takes you out to the white room where you crawl inside, we lock the astronauts inside, and they get ready to go launch. Also up here on the 195-foot level are the escape baskets. If during the final hours of the countdown there were an emergency and the crew were in the space shuttle, they would come running out of the crew module, come down this way, and then jump in one of these 7 slide wire baskets, hit a very simple mechanism which would release them, and they would slide down the wires to a safe area down at the bottom of the hill. Finally, about 4 hours prior to launch, after we've verified the whole vehicle is ready, someone gets to go wake up the astronauts in the crew quarters, if they're even sleeping. I don't know exactly what they'd be nervous about. But then they all get up, have their breakfast, get their final weather briefing, and then they put on their orange pumpkin suits and hop in the Astrovan, do their famous walk out, wave to everybody, and then they take that 20-minute ride out here to the launch pad. Once they arrive downstairs, 255 feet below us, then they hop out, get in the elevator, and take the ride up to the 195-foot level. Let's go down. And then once all the astronauts are safely secured inside the orbiter, we close the hatch, and all the really, really smart people in NASA get 3.5 miles away, leaving these 7 astronauts with about an hour to an hour and a half to contemplate the career decisions that they've made, which led them to be sitting on top of this explosive equivalent of a small nuclear weapon. There's really not a whole lot for the astronauts to do during that final hour and a half. So the astronaut commanders, they try to keep things light, I'm sure, inside the crew module during the final phases of the countdown. When we finally get to T-minus 6.6 seconds, we begin to ignite the main engines on the back of the orbiter. Now, it only takes 3 seconds for them to come up to full power. And so you might well ask, well then, why do you start them at T-minus 6.6 seconds? Ah, bear with me here. The reason is, as those engines ignite, they will bend the external tank as much as 3 feet up at the very top because of their thrust. And it takes them about 6 seconds to bend and then twang back to pure vertical. And that's why we do it at 6.6 seconds. We don't want to be launching when the orbiter and the whole vehicle have bent like this. So finally at T0, we're all ready to go. We are so sure that the solid rocket boosters are going to ignite that we send the command to blow the bolts, holding the vehicle to the ground first, then we send the command to ignite the boosters.
10, 9, 8, 7. We have a go for main engine start. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And liftoff of the Space Shuttle Endeavour on the first space ad mission and the retrieval of the Eureka spacecraft.
Each booster then goes from 0 to about 3 million pounds of thrust in less than half a second. That's quite a kick in the tush if you're sitting on top of the orbiter. And then they begin their climb out. You'll see when it gets to a point just about where it clears the launch tower there, that's where we turn over control from here in Kennedy Space Center to the folks at Johnson Space Center in Houston, Texas. It continues its climb out about 2 minutes and 6 seconds into flight. The boosters are done. They are jettisoned. They continue on in a giant arc somewhere about 150 miles out in the ocean. As they begin to fall back towards the Earth, a small chute will come out, and that will pull out three larger parachutes, which will gently lower the booster down into the ocean, where we have one of our ships and our NASA Navy waiting for it. They'll go out there, install a plug in the bottom, pump some of the water out, or pump air in, whichever way you want to think about it. Get the water out of there, the solid rocket booster will begin to float like this. Then we tow it back over here to the Cape Canaveral Air Force Station, where we clean it, inspect it, take it apart, and then we send it back to our friends in Utah at Thiokol. They will refill it with propellant, and then they send it back to us, and we reuse it. Now, this is all that's happening downstairs. You may remember when we last left our seven heroes, they were still going upstairs with the external tank attached. 8.5 minutes after T0, the external tank is essentially empty. It is jettisoned. It will continue on in its own giant arc, but usually somewhere over the South Pacific or the Indian Ocean, it will re-enter the Earth's atmosphere and burn up. Once we're up in space and we're in a nice orbit the way we want to be, one of the first things we do is we open the payload bay doors on the top of the orbiter. We do that because the payload bay doors, the inside of them, are giant freon-filled radiators that are used to cool all the hundreds of electronics boxes, as well as the cooling for the astronauts who are in the crew module. Once all that's done, we're ready to begin all that really cool stuff they have to do up in space. The astronauts can deploy a satellite. They can either spin it up and kick it out, or they can use the Canadian robot arm to lift it up out of the payload bay, hold it just above there, and then gently release it, and then the orbiter will back away, leaving it there in that orbit. The other thing they can do is the astronauts can put on their own personal spaceship, their own spacesuit, and you go outside and play. It's just so cool. I can't imagine. Just here's your faceplate right here. Below you, 200, 300 miles below you, going by at 5 miles per second, is your home planet, and you're just floating above it. I can't imagine anything that would be cooler than being able to do that. Once we've done all that very cool stuff up in space, it's time to come home. Somewhere halfway around the world, sometimes over Australia, they'll turn the orbiter around backwards, fire those orbital maneuvering system engines again for the last time. At this point, the orbiter is really nothing more than a brick with wings. But because the astronauts are such good pilots and because they are trained so well, half a world away, finally back here at Kennedy Space Center, they bring it down to a perfect pinpoint landing almost every time. We hook up all of our safing equipment, make the vehicle safe for the astronauts to get out. They do that, and then we tow the orbiter back to the orbiter processing facility, and we start this whole process that I just described to you all over again. And that, my friends, is how we get shuttles ready to go fly here at Kennedy Space Center. Thank you.